We'll laugh. We'll smile like we're with those, like those, you know, like a carved putt-putt in a circus.
Yes, what? We're trying to appear so natural when you hit that record button, you know? I mean, it's hard to do. I'm Melinda McKinsey.
I'm Tom Wise.
Thanks for unpacking some shit with us today.
Man, I'm in Tarpon Springs. I'm so unhappy. It's in the 90s. Yesterday, it's in the 90s. Today, it's going to be in the 90s the next 5 days.
No. Okay, I'm pulling up our weather. Do you want to hear what our weather is today?
I'm going to be sick because I so love below 70 at night. I so love it.
It's 73 degrees here.
What's the low? 52?
55. 55. Tomorrow the high is 64.
I gotta get out of here. I'm selling the ranch.
Yes.
I'm heading north somewhere. I can't take just waiting for the weather to get cool. I gotta go make it happen.
What if you went? I know you like going to the west. What about like Montana?
Oh, yeah. Well, anything out of Florida is gonna be north.
Well, that's true too.
I'm thinking. Well, ideally, I'd like to maybe. I'm thinking about Denver. Or Idaho. It'd be nice to have a Florida home. You know, I don't like the winter. I like 40 to 80 is what I like. But who doesn't?
You're sounding a little bit like a snowbird.
I could snowboard. I get it. I want to chase weather in my old age.
Yeah. No, I think it's a smart idea to have that Florida house for the winters. And I've been obsessed lately with watching people living in vans and traveling. I've been thinking, should I do this? Like,
did you see Tina, my ex's van? She did that all. She's amazing.
She is.
She's no good with like a wrench. You know, I fixed the refrigerator, fixed the bike. She doesn't like wrenches, but man, screwdrivers and saws, that's her sweet spot. She built a duck house that belonged on a cover of a woodworking magazine. It had shingles on it, it had base on it, the whole nine yards, without drawings. She just went to the lumber yard, started putting shit in the cart, and then 4 days later, we're floating this duck house in the middle of the pond. It's like, holy crap. I mean, just amazing woodworking skill without a plan. She didn't draw, maybe she drew something on a napkin, but as far as measurements and things like that, wasn't like she got these plans from a magazine.
Where did she get that from? Did she grow up that way?
I don't know that her dad was like handy like that. She's always been like that. And I mean, she outfitted the van. There's no way she had an idea of what she wanted to do. So I helped her buy the van. She's no good at that, but give her the van. She took the seats out herself. She did all the measurements. She repurposed some old bunk bed wood that we had in the garage, and she That's made great. Sliders. She made shelves. She made places for stow the water. It was amazing. And when I got this, is like a craft that you'd pay a guy.
Oh yeah.
$1,800 to make this thing for you without the wood. This just to do it because it took 7 days.
Sure. Now what's amazing is she doing well.
She's doing great. She visited the kids. They had a little COVID scare. My girls are living with their boyfriends up in Chicago in an apartment, and they're all splitting the rent. Well, a common friend came down with the COVID. The girls are they're crazy about protecting themselves.
Right.
I mean, maybe a little overprotective, but if you're going to be crazy one way, because you're communal living, you know, you owe it to everybody else to be careful.
Yeah.
So they decided that mom couldn't come into the apartment till they got it all clear. So they went camping at the Indiana State Dunes for a couple of days.
Yeah.
And then and eventually they did go back to the apartment as everybody was tested and they were negative.
That's really good. I don't hear as much about the younger kids worrying about COVID, right? So that's interesting.
Well, my girls have never been a bar, party, beach, crowd. I mean, they're a group unto themselves. Yeah, so I think Tina's headed out west. She's heading out to Yellowstone, then Idaho, then the Arches.
Ooh, I'm so jealous.
On the way back. Yep.
Good for her. Good.
Yeah, amen.
For her.
She took all of October off.
That's because a good
Yeah, isn't that great? Well, it was funny. We were having a conversation about 2-3 months ago, and she says, "You know, the best month of my life was the month that we took off as a family and drove out to Idaho and spent a month in Idaho. We went to Yellowstone, and we lived in Sun Valley, Idaho for literally a month. We rented a house for a month, and that was a great month. I recommend that to anybody that can cobble it together. I know it might seem insurmountable, and especially if you have the type of job that won't let you off a month.
Right.
But if you're between jobs or you can make that happen, to take off a month, go rent a place somewhere, drive there, get there, and just relax for a little, because life just spins by. That was 12 years ago.
Wow.
15 years ago. Yeah, okay. Her sister was still alive. Yep.
Wow. Yeah, I miss travel. I mean, here in New York, we're actually rolling things back. Cuomo made some announcements. Him and de Blasio are fighting. Now we have the entire Hasidic community is fighting because they said, you can't stop us from our religious practices because they're trying to shut things down. We've had a big outbreak in the Hasidic community, and nothing against Hasidics in general, but you still belong to the larger community. So since you are a part of that, you have to adhere. Anyway, they're lighting fires in the streets. We've had protests since last night because they're saying no, they're not stopping their religion. They will go to their church and they will not wear masks.
Oy.
So what are you supposed to do about that? I'm so glad I don't live in that area because it's not right. I mean,
well, they also have problems with the measles and things like that too.
Yes.
Because they don't want to vaccinate.
So
it's it's a very interesting thing. We talked about that a little bit, you know. I mean, they've been there forever.
Yes.
But you do have to protect the community. So how do you ignore, you know, what's happening? I mean, we're protecting you by everybody wearing a mask.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I have to hope someone smarter than me is figuring it out. Because there's always been some controversy about that Hasidic community is so strong. They have their own bus system, their own school system. Everything is separate, yet they live in a community where others live as well. So, right. You know, you can't expose people. So we'll see what happens. But those riots and fires started last night. So it's always
so the Hasidic Jews are starting riots?
Yes. Look it up online. They started fires in the streets. And they're wearing no mask. And they're saying, you're not stopping us from practicing our religion. Because de Blasio said, you can't have large congregations right now. You've got to pull it back. And they said, yes, we can. So.
Well, I understand they're talking about cutting power and cutting water to those places.
They did it in Los Angeles. So, you know, it's unfortunate. And everything else is crazy too. So that just makes this feel even bigger, right? Because everything else feels crazy. Right. So everything feels more blown up than it ever was before. So.
All right. Let's get to our positive topics.
Yes. What are your positive topics?
I've got short money, which we haven't talked about.
Yes.
I talked about wins, weary, what's going on down there, COVID in the air, and lists.
Those sound fun. Think of those positive. I want to hear the positive COVID talk.
Oh, I just think that somebody should write the song to the tune of Love Is in the Air. You're singing right through the song. COVID's in the air.
I do
blah,
know
blah,
that
blah,
song.
Blah, 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 little Morocco, little cha-cha-cha.
I do know that song.
Right? I mean, that's an easy one.
Maybe if it has a theme song, it'll be easier to handle. COVID, you just play that. If you go to an area where there's COVID, they play the song and you know to back away.
Oh, yeah. It's like back away. Instead of a siren.
We just need to make it softer.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, I do have a couple left over from, you know, the other day. I have earliest childhood memory, and right. That's a memory you have as opposed to something your parents told you or a photo, because I think we get those confused, right? I'm curious how far back you can remember. And then parent traits. You know how we're always saying, I'll never do, you know, right. What my dad did. I want to go the opposite way. Speaking of positive, what are the positive parent traits that you feel like you picked up from your parents?
Oh, all right. I like that.
Right? And I even did that before I knew you were going to make me talk about positive things. And then what are you working on? And I'll tell you what that is later if we talk about it.
This mic always seems to be about an inch short.
It really, you know, you yeah, probably do.
Get me right there.
You do have ghosts.
I do have ghosts.
Well. I feel like your mic gets moved a lot.
Oh, I'm trying to find the spot. I'd like it here this side because it doesn't seem to be blocking me. And I also seem to have a better view towards you.
Yeah. And you can see your carry cart sign. And your flowers.
It's a sunny day.
right? Mm-hmm. So what would you like to speak of?
Let's do the positive parenting. You go first.
Okay. So like I said before, I think a lot of us have said, and we've heard other people say, well, my mom did, and I'll never do that, right? We focus a lot on the things we won't do.
Right.
It's a different mindset to think of, well, you know, I really want to focus on the good things my parents did. And I will say, for my mom, I was raised by my stepdad from the time I was 2 years old, and he was in the military, so he was gone all the time. So mom was like the main caretaker, right? My mom had a real sense of fun and adventure. My mom would do a lot of fun things for us. Like, you know, we'd build tents in the living room and, you know, we'd have like a popcorn night. I remember, this shows my age, but I'm 59. I don't care. Do you remember when the Wizard of Oz would play once a year? That was the big deal on TV.
Right around Thanksgiving-ish.
Around holiday time, it would play once a year on TV. We don't have the luxury we have now of watching anything anytime we want. So you had to plan around watching it. So our big thing was our mother, when Wizard of Oz was on, would allow us to get the TV trays out because we were never allowed to eat dinner and watch television. That was completely unacceptable. We would get the TV trays out, and not only could we watch the Wizard of Oz, she would fix fried shrimp and french fries. Blew my mind.
How nice is that?
And I'm 59. I still talk about it. It was such a big deal, that it was such an event, right? She had a real sense of fun. I remember once in high school, we argued a lot, but I remember once in high school, I was having just a hard time. And I was very active in high school, but you know, girls are mean and stuff. And I told my mom I wasn't feeling well, and she knew that wasn't true. And she said, "Do you just want to go shopping today?" Well, we didn't have money. Shopping wasn't a thing for us. But like, she knew I just needed some mom time. I just needed to not deal with the mean girls for one day. And I'll never forget it. I was 16 years old. I remember a million things I'm mad at her about. But honestly, she did so many cool things that helped my heart. You know, now, as far as my dad, here's the thing with my dad that raised me, he was a man of few words. So I love the fact. Yeah, mostly no, and mostly you're grounded. I was grounded a lot.
Wow.
But what I really respected about my dad was he was true to his word. If he said something, he meant it, and he was a very honorable man, and I respect that so much. With my biological dad that I met when I was 18, he was hilarious, naturally funny, drew a lot of people in, and knew how to make money. So those are the cool things I think that I'll always remember and kind of try to replicate from my parents, because those are really important qualities.
So your natural father spent time in jail for counterfeiting, correct?
My natural father?
Yeah.
He never went to jail.
I mean, for counterfeiting, because he knew how to make money.
Oh.
Sorry.
What are we talking about?
It was a weak callback.
Well, he was very good at making money. He was from Indiana. He moved to California after the military. He started buying real estate in LA, and he started a nursery business. And he just, this was in like, what, the 60s?
Oh my gosh.
He told me his one regret is when McDonald's, he had a chance to buy into the franchise, and he said, that'll never take off.
Who buys into hamburgers like that? You know, I had an opportunity to get involved with, what's that storage place where they come out and put a big storage locker on your driveway?
The pods,
yeah. I was invited to participate in the pods early as a friend of my daughter's, oldest daughter's, was an investor. So he never really offered me a spot because I was kind of doing something, but he, you know, floated it as an option that, you know, that'd be something we might be able to talk about.
Why were you not interested in that?
Well, I was doing some multi-level marketing thing that thought I was going to take off.
Crazy. Yeah, what a shame. So what about your parents? What are some things your parents did that you feel like, yeah, I've replicated it, or I'd like to replicate it?
Well, I tell you, I remember the shift that my mom made in her 50s after my dad had died. Dad was 56, mom was 54, I think. And she even said it at some point. She goes, I'm done worrying about the housework. If things are dusty, the house is always in good shape. I mean, we had 8 kids.
Yes.
And then by that time, I think when Dad died, there's probably 3 of us living at home.
Okay.
She says, I'm done with, you know, worrying about it. And then she relaxed. She traveled more with my sister. She worked. She enjoyed work. She enjoyed work. She got her RN degree in her 50s. And then she worked in the baby department. She, as a matter of fact, she was able to get, but two women on two different occasions were giving up their children for adoption. And mom secured both those babies for my brother, whose wife couldn't have kids.
That's incredible.
But she had a great relaxed attitude about life and about, you know, what's important. It's more important to travel, spend time with the kids, relax, and not just, floor needs to be mopped, everything. And then we always helped her out around the house, or at least that was my memory. We always had chores, but I just remember her saying there are more important things than, a dust-free, kitchen table. But not that the house was ever messy. Yeah. I couldn't even tell the difference anyway.
Yeah.
And my dad, I don't know that I've ever saw him angry. Very, very cruise through life guy.
Okay.
I think we had one weird conversation when I was, 14, and he had a couple of beers. And, he was like, wow, let me just tell you, it's not as easy as it looks. And that's the only time I was like, wow, who is this person? Because he never was drunk.
Yeah.
He had one beer extra, and he's about to tell me what's what. And he never was that guy.
Yeah. But
hard work at every weekend. Every weekend had a project. We're putting up paneling. We're pulling weeds. We lived in a postage stamp in Chicago. I mean, you could touch the houses in the gangway. Yep. My office is larger than the backyard.
Oh, yeah.
But it seemed like every week we're weeding. We're taking out rocks. We're every week. How much work can this be? There's five kids. There's five boys.
Yeah.
How much work can you have for us? But it just seemed that way in my mind. But, projects, learning how to repair things. I don't think we ever had a guy in the house, like a service technician.
Yeah.
It became a mystery to me. It's like, so you can call a guy in and he'll fix the dishwasher? I don't know.
Right.
I don't know that exists.
Yeah. Isn't it such a different world? My dad did everything, and we had chores. They were expected. We didn't get paid for them because we lived there. We tried that trick of you have a place to sleep. We feed you. I'm not paying you for anything. We all got jobs as soon as we could get jobs.
Right.
It's a different world. And like in today's world, now we have so many services where I called several people to come build furniture for me.
Ugh.
I
know what you should try to do it if you can.
Yes. Now the basic stuff I did, but there were shelving and things I knew that I couldn't do it, and it needed to be secure for all my books, and so I paid someone to come and do it.
And there's a wisdom in knowing what's above your pay grade. I've done the same thing too. I've had guys out here working on plumbing out here.
Yeah.
I've had guys working on electric out here. I'm not putting in 220, but I will try to do most anything myself first. I mean, I can wire a fan. I could put in a switch.
Yeah.
But it's funny because the few times that I have called people in for help, I was like, oh yeah, I never could have done that.
Yes.
This guy's running a wire underneath the cement sidewalk.
I
don't have the tools or the inclination, or would I do a good enough job or know what I'm doing to put all that effort into not knowing if it's going to pay off or not.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes it's worth spending a little bit of money to make sure it's done right, because I definitely had the bookshelves. I tried at first, and there were so many pieces, I thought, who am I kidding?
Right.
I'll never feel stable about it. Yep. And then I had a grill delivered, and I looked at it because I thought I could do it, and I thought, no, I can't. I'm too afraid.
It's especially with things like gas. You don't want to
screw up. Yes, that's what I thought. Yeah.
I got some guy from Craigslist to help me do – I had a punch list. I wanted to put in the ceiling when I bought the place was just loaded with wires.
Okay, okay.
I said wires all over the place. And I wanted somebody who knew what they were doing, get rid of the wires. Let's get this down to two fans. Oh, and can you put in a light here? And can you put in a switch here? This also ties in with my short money topic that I've been talking about for 3-4 weeks.
Okay, but I want to know why Craigslist.
I didn't want to spend – $85 an hour to have a professional guy come in.
Okay.
Craigslist. He said, yeah, I'm an electrician. Sure. And it's just a couple of fans. There you go.
But see, that's why I like TaskRabbit, because you get to pick your task, or they all have different rates.
That was 8 years ago, so.
Okay. Yeah.
Anyway, so the light that he installed is now falling out, and the switch box that he put in is now disconnected. It's also out of the wall.
Oh, no. But it was cheap.
Short money. Well, let's just do that topic since I've been yammering about it.
Yeah.
How many times did you decide to buy something that's not as you could afford more, but you wanted to save a little bit of money? The pool cleaner I bought was $700, not $1,200. I go, well, let's this thing's been nothing but trouble ever since I bought it.
Well, and the pool cleaner, you're going to use it all the time.
That's a heavy use item. I'm running it twice a day. And especially when the leaves come, I don't have a cage on the pool.
Right.
I know everybody's got the same problem. We can all relate.
You know,
I don't have a cage in the oversized pool.
But you're right about that.
Yeah. I mean, buy the best one you can afford, especially if it's a heavy use item. I've done that, and I told that to my kids. I mean, how many times you buy the shitty cordless phone back in 1987 only to throw it against the wall and go get the more expensive one that was only $15 more for the better unit, you know, that's actually usable.
It's more expensive always when you spend less in that way. And that is definitely a lesson I've been working with Alex, you know, since the pandemic and everything, we're trying to be cautious, and she'll look at something and say, well, this is cheaper. And I'll say, in the long run, it's more expensive.
You got to pick your spot, just like you've got to know whether you can build that shelf or not.
Yeah.
Know thyself.
Yeah, exactly. So it saves you money to spend more if it's a better quality. But the most expensive thing isn't always the best thing. And that's when you have to really look it up.
Right. I mean, like paint. Do I want to spend $28 a can or $12 a can? Well, I don't want to spend $28 a can, but you get 18 years out of that can versus 4 years out of the other can. So you mathematically lose the labor and the paint. And,
right.
Over the whole thing.
Right. I'm exhausted. No, but you know what? That's a lesson I wish they would teach in school, short money. That's like a basic thing you learn the hard way, I think, because my family never had money. So we were always kind of doing things on the cheap and fixing things ourselves. We never considered to go beyond our means. We didn't take out loans or do credit cards. That was ridiculous. Well,
but that was, I mean, you're living within your means. You don't, I'm talking about when you have an option, $30 for something, $80 for something.
Yeah, but I'm saying if something was broken in our house and the only way we could pay for it was a credit card, my parents wouldn't do it.
That's a learning experience too. Did they talk to you about that money cash flow, or did they talk to you about not using credit, or blah, 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 blah?
Only like if something happened. We never were taught in our family how to spend your money, or it was mostly like if we would ask a question, because my dad would always complain about taxes, and my family, my dad was in the military, he never really made a lot of money, and it's really sad because he worked very hard. After he left the military, he started working as an electrician at a grain bin in Indiana. And he went from working in the military as a chief petty officer to making minimum wage.
Wow. That's not how they sell it on the ads.
No, it is not how they sell it on the ads. No, it's a real thing. Yeah. And don't get me started on the VA.
Don't get me started.
That's a whole other nightmare.
We should do a whole segment called that.
Don't get me started.
Don't get me started.
It's actually a good one. Okay, that's a good one. All right, what's another positive thing you want to
talk about? You do one.
Okay, let's do earliest childhood memory.
All right.
This is something I've talked a lot with my sister and my niece about. I remember only moments of my childhood. I don't remember a lot, and I don't know if it's because we moved a lot. My family was in the military, we moved a lot. But when I try to really think of my own personal memory and not something my mom has told me and convinced me, but something I remember was kindergarten, getting a class picture taken. This isn't exactly a happy memory, but in kindergarten, in those days, they set us around the schoolroom. We weren't lined up on bleachers like you see now. They set us at desks and tables, and they were giving toys. So the kids were holding toys and doing things. And first of all, I was very insecure. I'm a middle kid. I always felt like I was lost. I was very quiet when I was young. All these other kids around me got toys and I didn't get a toy. And I remember trying not to cry in the picture because I was so sad that I didn't get a toy. And I should find that picture. I never did get a toy. I was devastated. And that's my earliest memory of like something that like stood out to me, you know, as a kid was kindergarten.
So you were five.
Yeah, five.
Oh. Five. Some mothers hold their kids back and they're six when they go to kindergarten.
Yeah, no. They wanted us out of the house. You don't need to stay here any longer than what you get out of here. So well, what about you?
It's funny. I have a distinct memory of thinking I was at Jimmy Marcioni's house, which is two doors down, and they had a walk-in basement where you walk down three steps and then walked right into the basement.
Uh-huh.
It was like a cement, I'm not going to call it like a cement bunker, but the stairs were cement and the hallway was cement and there was like a 4-foot wall.
Yeah.
So you walked down 4 feet and you walked into the basement.
Yeah.
And I remember that I hurt myself falling. I was trying to balance myself. Wasn't bad.
Okay.
But that always became like, and then when I was nine, somebody said, well, what's your oldest memory? And I guess I remember distinctly remembering to myself that I was four when I hurt myself at Jimmy Marcioni. So I've always had that memory that I knew I was four when that happened. And nothing bad happened, but I have just kind of a flash of the cement thing and, you know, the stairs the way they were. And,
yeah.
You know, but my memory is a funny thing where now I just have flashes of moments of, I can't remember 16 seconds of anything. I can remember when I was in kindergarten,
yes,
that a girl gave me a red leather strap, like a dog collar or a cat collar.
Why?
Like a little belt that had a little buckle on it.
Okay.
Well, she liked me and she gave me, like, I think she wrapped up like three Cracker Jacks, you know, boxes of Cracker Jack and put a little red leather strap on it.
Did you like it?
I like that. Who knows what happened to it, but I have that distinctive memory of that happening.
That's sweet.
Yeah, very sweet.
That's so sweet.
And then I have kind of flashes of Mrs. Raleigh, my fifth grade teacher, wasn't very nice. But I remember painting and napping and things like that. So I can do pretty much in fifth grade. And then when I was five.
Five, yeah.
And then that would have been 63. Was that the year Kennedy was shot or was that 64?
One, two, three. I thought it was three. I could be wrong.
I think I was in kindergarten when that happened.
Yeah, I don't remember that. I don't remember.
Oh, yeah. Huh? What year were you born? 62?
One.
61? Yeah, there's no way you could remember that. But I remember looking at that little box speaker up in the corner of the schoolroom when they made the announcement.
Oh. My first TV memory of something big happening was Nixon. When the Watergate stuff was happening, we lived in Biloxi, Mississippi. My dad was in the military, and my mom, TV wasn't a thing we watched all the time, right? It was like you would watch the news or something, and if we were lucky before we went to bed, we could watch a show that we all had to agree on. TV wasn't an ongoing thing. It was a gift. And my mom had the TV on during the day. Like, what is this? And you could see these old sweaty men talking. I just remember old sweaty men. I think our TV was even black and white, quite honestly. And I just remember being horrified because it felt scary. It felt scary.
Well, Nixon was in the late 60s, right? Yeah.
I guess. I mean, yeah. All so I remember is
7, 8, 9. Mm-hmm.
That my mom was doing unusual behavior. The TV was on during the day. She was watching it. It seemed to be bad stuff, and we were just in and out. And I remember thinking, whatever this is, I don't want to know about it. So that's the first scary TV thing. Now news is so different, right? You don't have to sit and wait. Where's the first? I asked my niece this. If something big happens, let's say, you know, something in politics that's super big, we're gonna have a war. Where's the first place you would look to confirm that is this happening?
What did she say? What do I say? Are you asking me?
I would like to know where you would go.
I tell you, oddly enough, I would go to Fox News, and then I would go to CNBC or MSNBC, whichever one wasn't having a commercial.
Okay. I think if something like that happened, they would just stop all the commercial stuff, right?
Of course. I'm just saying. But I don't find Fox News from 6 a.m. in the morning till 6 p.m. is to be very credible. I mean, they've got, I mean, hell, they ran the Joe Biden speech yesterday for half an hour.
Yeah.
So they're not, they're a legitimate source of news. They're downtown New York City. And I know everybody goes, you know, it's kind of a trigger. Oh, you're watching Fox. I don't watch Hannity or all their evening programming, which is opinion.
Right.
We know what they're going to say before they say it. So I'm bored. I don't need to reinforce whatever they think. And same thing. And MSNBC and CNBC, they do the same thing. Everybody's kind of an opinion person after the news. But I find that at least Fox gives me other news outside of the presidential stuff. Whereas you turn on CNBC at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they're bashing Trump. I get it. I like to bash Trump too, but is there anything else going on?
Right. Yeah. No, because it really made me think, you know, because the way that you can get the news is at so many sources now at your fingertips, what is the most reliable place to see something, you know, to really confirm, is this valid?
Yeah. Plus, let me say this. My current assortment of TV does not include NBC, ABC without me making an effort to get there. I probably would go to ABC, CBS, or NBC as a definitive whatever the hell is going on, but my quickest access would be to Fox.
Okay. Interesting.
But I would trust those other three sources as well. And I don't think Fox would give you bad news. I mean,
yeah, I do.
Don't think you'd skew the news.
No, that's such a good point, because people confuse Fox News with Fox commentary, which are two very different things.
Right.
Yeah. But it made me kind of reassess where I really do trust, because as a fun thing, I'll look at the networks and go, oh, that's funny. They're leaning this way. You can tell who leans.
Of course. Just by the verbiage, it's very interesting to see people describe the same situation using two different, you know, adjectives, you know?
Yes.
The crowd assembled to, you know, protest the blah, 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 blah. The angry mob got to, you know, all right, we know which way you're going on this, right?
Yeah. Exactly. Are you going to listen tonight to the debate between Kamala and Pence?
It's Kamala.
Kamala? Kamala.
Comma, like a comma.
Kamala.
Kamala.
Sorry. What did I say?
Please. Kamala.
Kamala. Kamala.
Kamala.
Apologies. Kamala.
Well, you know, when she became the vice president nominee or the selection, I even wrote down jokingly on Facebook, is it Kamala or Kamala? You know, people are like, well, what do you care about? Calm down. It's just a joke, because everybody says the same thing. Kamala, Kamala. So I learned Kamala, Kamala.
You actually can get a conversation. You can get 100 people to comment when you make eggs. It's ridiculous, because you say just the right thing and people just like, well, let me tell you how I make my eggs. And I'm like, my God.
Oh, did they see the egg? I got this egg thing down to a science. Can I show you? Speaking of
you
eggs,
absolutely can show me the egg science. Show me what you got.
Look at this. I perfected the egg sandwich. It's been perfected. Don't anyone even bother.
Don't bother.
Oh, you can't even see that.
That is, it, the reflection is a little much. This is, if you want to know how to make this, go to Tom's Facebook page, as he has done a video with quite a bit of commentary on how it works.
It's delightful. It's 4 minutes.
It's his go-to. You know what I made that was so different yesterday? We have bought all kinds of backup foods for the winter, just in case weird things happen and we can't get to the store.
Is it mostly ice cream?
No, we bought Spam. Now, have you ever had Spam?
Sure.
So we grew up with Spam. We lived in Hawaii, and it was like kind of the thing. And my mom used to take French loaf, mozzarella cheese, chop up the Spam, and broil it. And it was fantastic. So yesterday, I felt like macaroni for some reason. I'm still doing my intermittent fasting. So I wanted some macaroni. So I fried the Spam and put it in the macaroni, thinking it would be really disgusting. But I wanted, it was fantastic. It was so good. And Will and Alex even liked it too. They're like, hey.
Give us a little history. I understand Spam is very popular in Hawaii. I never knew why. And then they got like 14 different varieties of it on the shelf or something.
Yes. You know
what? Is that your experience?
Yes. I mean, Spam was a normal part of life. I didn't know it wasn't normal till we moved to the mainland and nobody had it. My understanding is that it's just because it's cheap and it lasts forever. And, you know, we're a military family. We didn't have a lot of money. I don't know if it's a cultural thing that there's some kind of a better history maybe for Spam in Hawaii.
I know, but what about the variety of it though?
Yes, there's all kinds of different types of Spam. And since I was a kid, I never bought it. I just remember going and there was Spam everywhere. I mean, Spam was a normal part of our
week. What kind of Spams are common to buy? Because right here, if you go to the Publix, you're going to see one Spam.
Oh, you know, I don't know what's the most common, to be real honest with you, Tom. Oh. I just know, I'm sorry.
You can see the look in my eyes.
I know your eyes are twitching.
I put something on a tee for you. Here you go. You can be the Spam expert.
But I'm not. I can't make it up. I'm not. I was impressed that I even bought regular Spam. I thought, you know what? I don't know as an adult if I'm going to enjoy this anymore because it was a kid thing. And it was because it was cheap. It wasn't because it was good.
Yeah, I could. I don't think I would eat Spam, like cut it like a ham sandwich. But maybe I could cook it in something, you know, crisp up or something.
Very slimy when you open it.
Yeah, like corned beef hash. I could eat that cooked up.
Yeah, it was. I recommend Spam chopped up fried with macaroni and cheese. It's very good. So in case we all run out of food this winter and you can't get any food at all, get some Spam.
And that's today's tip of the day.
Yeah. So
we used to have Spam. We had Spam sparingly at the Wise House. It wasn't greeted with disgust, and it wasn't like, oh, good Spam. It's like, all right, Spam, gotcha.
See, my parents used to make liver and onions once a week, and that drove us crazy. Wow. None of us kids liked it, but my parents were big fans of liver and onions, and we had to eat it. It's not like you could say I don't like it.
I wasn't ever a big fan of liver.
No, it's terrible.
It seemed to be a little hard.
It's really terrible. Did you have regular meals your mom would make, or was it, my mom too?
Yeah, there was probably 10 different things, and you rotated. Yeah. And it was always exciting having breakfast for dinner every now and again.
That was so exciting. What? Are you crazy having breakfast for dinner? It's so funny how the times have changed and how things that were fancy back then are just an everyday, no big deal kind of.
I know, the one thing I miss, because Tina and I, when the kids were young and whatever, our schedules were so crazy.
Yeah.
We were always like, you know, I mean, dinner was 5:30 at my house on the dot.
Oh.
You know, whenever I was a kid. And then the only reason you'd miss dinner is if you were doing sports or you had work. But you couldn't. Oh, I was at Larry's house. I just have dinner without me. No. Everybody's there. All hands on deck. I mean, imagine having 10 kids around the table, or 8 kids and two parents.
Did your mom do all the cooking, or did you guys help her cook?
Mom essentially did all the cooking.
Wow. That's a lot.
I mean, she used to have a loaf of bread that when she was making sandwiches, lunches for, think about it. She had 3 in high school at the same time. And then forever, it seemed. And then, you know, then us kids would come home for lunch from grammar school, just making sandwiches all day long.
You know, another big thing my mom would do is potato soup. Is that something you guys ever did, potato soup?
Mom was a good cook. She was bad at making soup and bad at making stew.
My mom made great pies and fudge. She was known for her fudge.
Mom made fudge, but it all went to my brother going off to Vietnam. He didn't go to Vietnam, but he was served in the Navy during the conflict.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and you know what? In our era, too, that was more normal that people participated in the military. It's not so much anymore.
Well, the governor wanted him to go. He was drafted, yes. And he joined the Navy to avoid going to Vietnam, which we're all excited about that.
Do you think if they implemented a mandatory draft, it would go well? Mm-mm. That's such a horrifying thing to be told. You will go fight in a battle.
It's horrible. It's unbelievable. Oh. When you think about Vietnam, it's horrible. It's horrible. America pivoted at that point. Up to that point, every war was justified, and we were on the right side, and that was just a mess. 50,000 kids later, and who knows how many lives ruined over that nonsense.
Right.
They knew it was bad from the beginning.
How did your brother handle it when he was drafted?
I think his plan was not to go to Vietnam. So he just signed up. He walked over to the Navy's recruiter and said, hey, can you help me out here? Yes, we can. And and he served on a boat in the Mediterranean. I think he had a great time. I think he was went out there and they visited Greece and Italy. And it was like
Good for him.
Way to go. He was, he learned how to cut hair.
Wow. Okay.
I think he was in there for 4 years.
Wow. Well, I mean, my dad retired from the military, and so it was our whole world. And I will say, at the time, it seemed like a nightmare because we moved a lot. I was always the new kid, and you always felt like an outsider. But looking back on it, I appreciate it so much. I got to see so much, and it taught me how to kind of go out and realize that if I wanted to be a part of something, I had to reach out. You know, when I finished high school in Indiana. Guess what? In Indiana, everybody's born and raised there. They went to the same school from kindergarten through high school. And here I was, this stranger. I was the total outcast because who are you? You're not, who are you related to? Who? Thank God I had a cousin that went to the same high school. I think they would have just hung me by a rope if I hadn't, because they don't trust outsiders.
You know, unless you've got a special skill. Now see, you know, I remember this kid, I think his name was Jimmy, coming into the neighborhood, him and his brother. I mean, we were an established group by 14 years old, 13 years old. Uh-huh. Not to do many strangers, not like Indiana. So this is Chicago.
Yeah.
But Jimmy and his brother, Jimmy could play baseball like the Dickens. He's like, wow, this kid may be better than me. This is crazy because I've been the best person playing outfield for the longest time. So it was weird. But we embraced him because he could play, because he could always use more players. When you're trying to play baseball, you're trying to assemble 18 guys.
Aww.
Good luck. So you only end up with 7, 9, 12, and you're chopping people up. So, yeah. So if you came in with a special skill, like, I don't know, what like a cheerleader, you could do something that other people couldn't do.
Well, I had been in cheerleading.
Valuable to the group.
Well, I had been in cheerleading all in my years in Hawaii, and so I did try out for cheerleading, and it was
they see you as competition too.
Yeah, they didn't like it at all. The girls hated me automatically because I tried out for freshman cheerleader, and I made it, and it was the end of the fucking world. How dare this new person? Here's how terrible it was. My nickname was Mindy. Everybody called me Mindy in school. This is how antiquated Mindy was my nickname. That's what they called me all through school. So when you tried out, you had to try out in front of all these teachers, and you know, it was very much a popularity contest. Then they wrote the names and posted them outside the teacher's room the next day. So you had to go to school, which you had to ride the bus. You couldn't get there any earlier. So everybody's running before the first period to look at the sign. It's just like a horrible high school movie.
I've had that experience myself when they're posting to see who made the cut for a basketball.
Yes. So I'm running up thinking, I knew I wasn't going to make it. I knew I was a stranger. But I was really proud of the fact that I tried because I was very insecure little freshman. And remember, I hadn't had my period yet. I had no body. I was this little rail of a girl. As I walked up, the popular girls were standing there, and the most popular one of all, Sherry Lewis, she had money, her dad owned Kentucky Fried Chicken, she was so popular, she was reading the list, and she said, Mindy, what, and people, and I was standing right there, and I remember thinking, well, this is going to be super fun. And it took a while before they would actually take me in because all of them but one were rich. You know, they all had power. They all had social status. I was the new poor girl. But I knew cheerleading. I was, you know, very active. So.
Can you, could you imagine a scenario now?
Yes.
When you got 5, 6 teachers sitting in a room deciding what's what. And then somebody that you never met, you don't even know about, somebody said, you know what? I used to be that outside girl. Let's give this Mindy a try. So somebody stood up for you in that crowd that you never know. You never knew about. You never get to acknowledge that somebody said, because clearly there was this group that they traveled with ever since the third grade.
Yes. Yes.
And that group was tight knit. And so do you think they added you or did they subtract somebody?
They subtracted a very popular girl by the name of Kelly Brown.
Kelly Brown.
And everybody loved Kelly Brown. And thank God she made up for it because our senior year she was prom queen. So she made up for it. But it was quite the controversy. How dare I kick out Kelly Brown? Very controversial.
Okay, let me ask you a question. Do you think you were more talented than Kelly Brown?
You know, to be honest with you, I will.
Please, that's what we're asking for. This is the whole podcast is lynched on being honest.
Yes,
welcome to a bunch of crappy lies.
I was involved in acrobatics. I had a different style of cheerleading because I had been a cheerleader from the time I was a small kid. I think I was different in a good way where they felt like I could teach them different things. And I had competed in competitions in Hawaii. So I think, yes, I think I did deserve to be on there. But I think someone had to fight for me because it did break up the quid pro quo. Definitely. Yeah. And then I went on to stay in cheerleading. I was a cheerleader every year, but my junior year, you had to try out for every season. And it was really the highlight of my senior year. And some people might think it's superficial, but I got great joy out of cheerleading and going to the games and supporting and stuff. Sure.
So what happened to your junior year?
I don't know, man. I tried out like normal, and I didn't make it for the football season. I have no idea. Kelly was back. Kelly got in. I was out.
Was there a little bad blood between you and Kelly? Like she's your nemesis?
No, she was a lovely human being. She was kind to me. No, not at all, really. I was really actually very impressed with her attitude because she could have hated me, but she really didn't. She was a lovely girl. I don't know why I didn't
get her on the podcast.
I should get her on the podcast, but here's the thing. As the years progressed, they changed the tryouts to then you had to go early. And whoever wanted to judge, the entire school got to show up and you had to try out in front of the whole school. And then for each season, say it was football, they would give you a football play and they would ask you what cheer would you use. So you had to know offense and defense. Like it became a thing.
That's crazy. So now, well, that truly is a popularity contest.
Yes. And then it became a popularity contest. But here's the thing, a lot of the kids that wouldn't normally vote for something like that showed up to vote. And I think that's the only way I got in. I would say it was part of the popular crowd. I never really became a part of that crowd, to be honest with you. I had more guy friends than girlfriends.
In the honesty, go ahead.
And I think I always remained the outsider, which I didn't love. But what can you do if people don't want to take you in? They don't want to take you in.
When you have a bake sale at your house. That's when you're having a pajama party at your house.
I felt like I couldn't compete. You know, we were very poor. I lived way out. I was not very poor. We couldn't afford a lot of things. I was working. I had to pay for all my cheerleading outfits. My parents couldn't afford it. It was quite expensive. You know, so it was all of this stuff. But I enjoyed cheerleading. I was very involved. I was in drama and volleyball and track. I did all the stuff. But I will say, is something wrong with your wrist?
I'm just trying to help myself.
What's going on there? I've never seen you do that. Have you hurt yourself? Okay. I thought you hurt yourself. So
I do a joke when here's the paralyzed guy saying hello.
Oh my gosh, Tom.
It's horrible.
Horrible, Tom.
Or I put my hand on the electric window. It's a hit with the kids when they were 7. Watch this.
Well, as long as the 7-year-olds like it, that's all that really matters, Tom.
Amen.
So, do you want to do a tip of the day before
we
go?
We're almost done with the show. We've been yammering on for almost an hour.
No, I have so much more.
Save it for the next day. Friday coming up.
Friday is coming up.
I want to do what's going on down there, and that's going to be exciting. But we're going to do that on Friday. But before we say goodbye. What's going on behind you with the cake?
A friend of mine is an artist. I bought this when I first moved to Brooklyn. She does many different, like a decoupage kind of a thing. I've never really been told.
Everything's an ad with you, isn't it?
What?
Everything's an ad, yeah.
You know, this lady does some great artwork, and I just thought it was hilarious because I love sugar. And it hangs up in my kitchen, and I was looking around today thinking, you know what would be fun to put on the show? Is this great little, you know, sometimes you have things on the wall and you forget to look at them.
Yes, I like it.
And yeah, and so I just think it's an interesting piece of art.
What's on the back?
What's on the back?
It's just clay. Is that like ceramic?
No, yeah, it's just a wood.
Oh, that looks like it's made out of stone.
Yeah, it's decoupage, you know, so it's all shiny and stuff. And I have another one of a woman in chains with donuts and candy all around her.
Let's get that next time.
We'll do that next time. Yes.
Done and done. My name's Tom Wise.
Yes, I'm Melinda McKinsey.
And you've been unpacking some shit. My gosh, this was like getting to know Melinda and Tom day on the show.
Hope you liked it.
Nothing's wrong with that.
Nope.
All right, see, what day is today, Wednesday?
Today is Wednesday.
Wow, the week is flying by. See you on Friday. Enjoy the debates tonight.
Enjoy the debates. We're going to have to talk.